Hi, good morning and welcome to the Breakfast News on Rajya Sabha Television, your one-stop morning show for top stories from India and across the globe. I'm Aishwarya. Let us start the news bulletin with the headlines. Massive rescue and relief operations on in Andhra Pradesh and Odisha after severe cyclonic storm Titli leaves behind a trail of destruction. 8 killed in Andhra, 1 in Odisha. Prime Minister assures all possible assistance to the chief ministers of both the states. National Green Tribunal directs 23 states and union territories to prepare action plans to improve air quality standards within 2 months. Forms Air Quality Monitoring Committee. Asks central and state pollution control boards to develop a public grievance redressal portal. With the target for a $400 billion turnover in domestic electronics manufacturing by 2025, Centre releases a draft National Electronics Policy 2018, aimed to push a startup ecosystem in emerging technology areas. Over 900 prisoners released from prisons across the country in first phase of Centre's special amnesty scheme to mark 150th birth anniversary of Mahatma Gandhi. Second and third phase of the scheme to be marked on 6th of April and 2nd of October next year. And India to take on West Indies in the second and final test of the two-match series in Hyderabad today. India already 1-0 ahead in series. Medals tally at Asian Para Games swells to 50. The top story this morning, the severe cyclonic storm Titli and widespread rains hit eastern India on Thursday, killing 8 people in Andhra Pradesh and 1 in Odisha. Meanwhile, various state agencies are struggling to restore normalcy after cyclone Titli wreaked havoc in both the states. The storm is gradually weakening and is now moving towards the northeast direction.
Rescue and relief operations are on full swing in the severe cyclonic storm Titli hit coastal areas of Odisha and Andhra Pradesh. Cyclonic storm Titli made landfall on the eastern coast of Odisha and Andhra Pradesh on Thursday, claiming several lives. The very severe cyclonic storm left a trail of destruction in Gajapati and Ganjam districts of Odisha, uprooting trees, electronic poles and damaging houses. Even in Andhra Pradesh, the cyclone caused widespread damage in Srikakulam and Vijayanagaram, throwing normal life out of gear. More than 2,000 electric poles were uprooted by the strong winds.
Actually, at the moment, whatever preliminary report we have till received, there are many places that trees have been uprooted, and from Barampur and Gopalpur stretch, some electric poles have been uprooted. But due to heavy rainfall, many low-lying areas have been affected.
Flights and train services between Andhra Pradesh and Odisha have also been affected because of the cyclone. The road network in Srikakulam district of Andhra suffered extensive damage, while the power distribution network has also been severely affected. Traffic on the Chennai-Kolkata National Highway was also hit at places due to the uprooted trees.
So, जिला प्रशासन हमको पूरा अलर्ट किया है और जिला प्रशासन से हमारा पंचायत से हर आदमी को हम जितना कोशिश करके सुबह से अभी तक सचेतन कर रहे हैं सब माउथ से अलाउंस करके सचेतन किया.
Odisha Chief Minister Naveen Patnaik reviewed the situation in the state and instructed officials to expedite restoration efforts once the situation improves. He also directed officials concerned to provide relief materials to cyclone-affected people. 13 team of National Disaster Response Force and Orissa Disaster Rapid Action Force have been deployed in affected areas along with fire brigade personnel.
Since there was a warning that there will be a storm surge of 1 meter, so we identified the vulnerable areas and we shifted people to our shelters. We have a large number of multipurpose cyclone shelter which have been built all over the state, and in more than 1,100 shelters we evacuated and kept about 300,000 people overnight. Wanted to ensure that our target of achieving zero casualty in a situation like this. So we had an elaborate preparation, and we are successful in doing that.
Today evening, abhi a severe cyclonic storm hai, but iska by today evening a cyclonic storm ho jayega. Uska baad fir aur weakening hoga, recurving hoga, weakening bhi hoga. Tomorrow morning tak a deep depression. Tomorrow morning tak deep depression rahega. Uska baad fir depression ho jayega.
Cyclone Titli, which was categorized as a very severe cyclonic storm, is moving towards West Bengal and is expected to weaken gradually with decreasing wind speed. Bureau report, Rajya Sabha TV.
And Prime Minister Narendra Modi on Thursday spoke with the chief ministers of Andhra Pradesh and Odisha and assured them all possible help to deal with the aftermath of Cyclone Titli. In a tweet, Prime Minister Modi also prayed for the safety and well-being of those affected by the cyclone. On to the other top story, the National Green Tribunal has directed 23 states and union territories, including the national capital Delhi and Chandigarh, to prepare action plans within 2 months to bring the air quality standard within the prescribed limit. Noting that there are 102 cities where the air quality does not meet the national ambient air quality standards, the panel formed an air quality monitoring committee. The NGT said the chief secretaries of the states and administrators of the union territories will be personally accountable for failure to formulate action plans. The NGT said that the committee will function under the supervision of principal secretary environment of the concerned state and union territory. The action plans have to be forwarded to the committee by December 31st and the committee chairman will approve the same by 31st of January next year. The NGT asked the CPCB and the State Pollution Control Boards to develop a public grievance redressal portal for air pollution complaints and a supervisory mechanism for their time-bound disposal. On to other news, Prime Minister Narendra Modi on Thursday said that a fourth industrial revolution can take India to new heights. Launching a centre for the fourth industrial revolution based in Mumbai, Prime Minister Modi said that the government has taken major initiatives for the fourth industrial revolution over the last 4 years. Here are all the details.
Effective coordination among diverse technologies is leading to the fourth industrial revolution, said Prime Minister Modi at the launch of the centre for the fourth industrial revolution on Thursday. He further said his government is open to policy changes to help reap its benefits. The Prime Minister asserted that the launch of the centre in India after San Francisco, Tokyo and Beijing has opened doors to infinite possibilities for India. He added that technological advances can take development in India to new heights.
Mera drad vishwas hai ki industry 4.0 ka istemal karke Bharat ki garibi ko समाप्त करने में बहुत अहम भूमिका निभाई जा सकती है देश के गरीब वंचित वर्ग को समाज के उपेक्षित वर्ग के जीवन को बेहतर बनाया जा सकता है
Listing the components of the fourth industrial revolution, Prime Minister Modi mentioned artificial intelligence, machine learning, internet of things, blockchain and big data, all of which he said will change the nature of jobs and provide more opportunities. The Prime Minister informed that the government is working to improve people's lives and prepare youth for changing technologies through schemes like Skill India, Startup India, Atal Innovation Mission, Digital India and others.
Aadhaar, Unified Payment Interface, yani UPI, e-sign, e-National Agriculture Market, yani e-NAM, Government e-marketplace यानी जैम, डीजी लॉकर जैसे यूनिक इंटरफेसेस भारत को आर्टिफिशियल इंटेलिजेंस के माध्यम से टेक्नोलॉजी लीडर बनने में मदद कर रहे हैं इनकी वजह से ज्यादा लोग तेजी के साथ डिजिटल टेक्नोलॉजी से जुड़ रहे हैं
promising that the fourth industrial revolution will make an astonishing contribution to the country. Prime Minister Modi said India's diversity, demographic potential, fast-growing market size and digital infrastructure have the potential to make the nation a global hub for research and implementation. Panchanand Mishra's report for Rajya Sabha TV.
And Rajya Sabha Television spoke to Niti Aayog CEO Amitabh Kant, who said that India is moving forward with the technological advancements. He said that the new Industrial Revolution Centre will provide fresh opportunities for digital initiatives.
सर ये जो औद्योगिक क्रांति की बात की जा रही है भारत में मुंबई में सेंटर बन रहा है तो क्या बदलाव आने वाला है देश में इससे
नहीं देखिए प्रधानमंत्री जी ने जैसे कहा कि डिजिटल इंडिया में बहुत प्रोग्रेस हुई है हमारे यहाँ पिछले चार साल में जो डेटा है उसका रेट बहुत गिरा है हमारा जो डेटा कंजम्पशन है वो चाइना और अमेरिका से ज़्यादा डेटा है तो इस समय एक ऐसा समय है जबकि हम कई चीज़ों में प्रोग्रेस कर सकते हैं उन्होंने ये भी कहा कि जब पहला इंडस्ट्रियल क्रांति हुई थी और दूसरी इंडस्ट्रियल क्रांति हुई थी तब हम गुलाम थे तीसरी क्रांति के समय हम अपनी गरीबी से जुड़ उस समय कई दिक्कतें थीं पर फोर्थ इंडस्ट्रियल रेवोल्यूशन के लिए हम पूरी तरह तैयार हैं और हमें इसको उपयोग करके कई एरियाज़ हैं आर्टिफिशियल इंटेलिजेंस ब्लॉकचेन इनको हम अपनी गरीबी को कैसे ज़्यादा प्रगति कर सकें कैसे हम लोगों को पॉवर्टी लाइन से आगे ले जा सकें इसमें कैसे उपयोग कर सकते हैं कैसे हम अपने फार्मर्स की इनकम को डबल कर सकते हैं और प्रोडक्टिविटी के लिए कैसे उपयोग कर सकते हैं या हेल्थ क्षेत्र में जब हम प्राइमरी हेल्थ केयर सेंटर्स को लिंक कर रहे हैं तो उसमें कैसे आर्टिफिशियल इंटेलिजेंस को यूज़ करें या लैंड रिकॉर्ड के लिए कैसे ब्लॉकचेन को उपयोग करें तो ये बड़े इनोवेटिव एरियाज हैं जहाँ टेक्नोलॉजी को उपयोग करके हमें क्वांटम जंप लेनी ज़रूरी है
सर पीएम ने एक ये बात कही कि आमतौर पर डर रहता है कि कोई इंडस्ट्रियल रिवोल्यूशन होगा तो नौकरियां चली जाएंगी जॉब में कमी होगी उन्होंने कहा इससे जॉब बढ़ेंगी और
नहीं तो ज़रूर नए देखिए जॉब ज़रूर बढ़ेंगी नए तरीके के जॉब्स बढ़ेंगी और इसके लिए एजुकेशन क्षेत्र में बहुत बदलाव लाने की ज़रूरत है जो कि गवर्नमेंट कर रही है अटल इनोवेशन मिशन से और हमने करीब 3000 नए टिंकरिंग लैब्स खोले हैं जहाँ छठी क्लास के बच्चे रोबोट 3D प्रिंटर्स और इंटरनेट ऑफ थिंग्स के साथ बड़े होते हैं और तो ये एक बहुत बड़ी क्रांति आई है और इससे हमें स्किल नए स्किल सेट्स लाने पड़ेंगे और मल्टी टास्किंग करनी पड़ेगी तो ये सब ज़रूरी है देश में और ये जब डिजिटाइजेशन इतना हुआ है इसके साथ साथ ये भी बदलाव आ रहे हैं बड़े ज़ोरों से
And Finance Minister Arun Jaitley says that there has been a 15-20% gradual increase in tax collections every year. Addressing the concluding session of the 29th Conference of Accountants General in New Delhi on Thursday, Arun Jaitley said that direct tax collections are increasing due to strict compliance. He further said that the government initiatives are likely to double the number of direct taxpayers to 7.6 crore. Jaitley said that when the NDA government came to power, the number of people who filed income tax returns was 3 crore 80 lakhs and it has now reached 6 crore 86 lakh in the last 4 years. The conference was organized by the Office of Controller and Auditor General of India.
The economy has been increasingly becoming formalized. In an informal economy, large amount of non-tax compliance takes place. Predominance of cash is there. And as the economy gets formalized, with each day you move in the direction of the government being able to bring more and more people into the formal sector of the economy.
And Vice President M. Venkaiah Naidu on Thursday said that the private sector could play a bigger role in accelerating the pace of India's inclusive growth and its motive should not only be making profits. He said that the efforts are also needed to ensure that weaker sections get equal opportunities. Addressing an event at the Tamil Nadu Chambers of Commerce in Chennai, Naidu said that the Chambers of Commerce works as a bridge between the governments and industry. The Vice President also pointed out several areas where the private sector needs a self-regulation, where the Chamber of Commerce should play an important role. The Vice President further said that all countries should ensure that economic offenders should not be given asylum in their countries to prevent investors from being cheated.
World is changing at a rapid pace, aided by technological and digital revolutions. Any nation unable to keep pace with changes will become obsolete. India is at the threshold of becoming one of the major economic power, and the private sector can play a big role in accelerating the growth and development of the country. The entire world today, the economy is slowing down, but India is one place which is very bright and where everybody wants to invest in India.
And Prime Minister Narendra Modi will address a special function in New Delhi today to mark the Silver Jubilee celebrations of the National Human Rights Commission. The National Human Rights Commission, NHRC, is completing 25 years of its existence with its 26th Foundation Day today. Extended Silver Jubilee celebrations spilling over 3 days are being organized to mark the occasion. And at the event at Vigyan Bhavan, Prime Minister Modi will release a commemorative first day postal cover and a stamp. A new version of the NHRC website will also be launched. The NHRC is organizing a Human Rights Mela and Human Rights Street Theatre Festival in Delhi on Saturday. And on Sunday, the Commission is organizing a Human Rights Walk to generate awareness about various aspects of human rights. In Breakfast News, time for a very short break. We'll be right back with more news. Welcome back after the break. The country's draft electronics policy released by the IT Ministry has set an ambitious target of creating a $400 billion electronics manufacturing industry by 2025, with the mobile devices segment accounting for 3/4 of the production. The proposed policy aims to double the target of mobile phone production from 500 million units in 2019 to 1 billion by 2025 to meet the objective. The policy also aims to promote a domestic manufacturing in the entire value chain of electronic system design and manufacturing for spurring economic development. The draft states that a $400 billion turnover shall include targeted production of 1 billion mobile handsets by 2025, valued at 190 billion, including 600 million mobile sets, valued at $110 billion for export. Now, according to the draft, the government plans to end modified special incentive scheme with schemes that will find easier to implement, such as interest subsidy and credit default guarantee, etc. More than 900 prisoners have been released from jails across the country under an amnesty scheme announced as part of the year-long celebration to mark the 150th birth anniversary of Mahatma Gandhi, beginning 2nd of October. Women convicts aged 55 years and above and male convicts of 60 years or more who have served half of their sentence and a few other categories of prisoners were eligible for the amnesty scheme announced by the centre in July. And in the week-long first phase of special remission to prisoners, the states and union territories, after obtaining the approval of the competent authority in their jurisdictions, have released more than 900 prisoners. And in the second and third phase, prisoners will be released on 6th of April 2019 and 2nd of October 2019, respectively. Defence Minister Nirmala Sitharaman on Thursday held wide-ranging talks with her French counterpart Florence Parly on ways to deepen strategic and defence cooperation between the two countries. The talks were held under the framework of the annual Indo-French Defence Ministerial Dialogue, which was agreed to during the summit meeting between Prime Minister Narendra Modi and French President Emmanuel Macron in March. The official sources said that the two defence ministers held a one-on-one meeting followed by delegation-level talks covering a range of bilateral, regional and global issues of mutual interest. Both the sides also deliberated on co-production of military platforms and weapons by the two countries. And External Affairs Minister Sushma Swaraj is in Tajik capital Dushanbe to attend the Shanghai Cooperation Organization's Council of Heads of Government meeting. Now, SCO's CHG is expected to focus on boosting cooperation in fighting terrorism, besides deliberating on pressing regional and global issues. And on Thursday, on the sidelines of the SCO two-day conclave, Sushma Swaraj met Afghanistan's Chief Executive Officer Abdullah Abdullah, and the two leaders held wide-ranging talks on the issues of mutual and regional interest. And Ministry of External Affairs spokesperson Ravish Kumar tweeted, taking stock of India-Afghanistan strategic partnership, continuing the high-level exchanges with Afghanistan at every opportunity. And earlier in the day, Sushma Swaraj met her Tajik counterpart as well, and the two leaders discussed stepping up close bilateral ties in development assistance, science and technology, health, defense and security. Sushma Swaraj also addressed the Indian diaspora in Tajik capital.
ये मध्य एशिया में भारत के प्रति जो एक प्यार, एक प्रेम की भावना है, वो यूं ही नहीं बन गई। वो इसलिए बनी कि हमारी फैमिली वैल्यूज, हमारे पारिवारिक मूल्य, हमारी संस्कृति एक दूसरे से मिलती है। उन पारिवारिक मूल्यों के कारण इन देशों को भारत अपना लगता है और भारत को ये देश अपने लगते हैं। और मैं ये कहना चाहूंगी कि वर्तमान सरकार के कार्यकाल में इन देशों के साथ हमारा रिश्ता जितना ऊंचा हुआ है, वो आगे और ऊंचा होता जाएगा।
And a top US envoy on Iran is headed to India this week to hold talks over Iran oil import. The visit of a special representative for Iran, Brian Hooker, to India comes ahead of the 4th of November deadline set by President Donald Trump administration for countries to bring down their import of Iranian oil to zero. Now, Hooker and Assistant Secretary of State for Energy Resources, Francis Fanon, will meet with their counterparts for consultations. And in addition to India, Brian Hooker will also be traveling to Europe to further discuss U.S. foreign policy towards Iran. The U.S. State Department said that during his week-long trip, Hooker will engage allies and partners on our shared need to counter the entirety of the Iranian regime's destructive behavior in the Middle East and in their own neighborhoods. It said it expected all the allies and friends to bring down their purchase of the Iranian oil to zero or be ready to face punitive sanctions beginning 4th of November. All the sporting action now. India will take on West Indies in the second and the final test in Hyderabad today. India defeated West Indies by an innings and 272 runs in the opening test in Rajkot last Saturday to register their biggest ever win in test cricket. Now, India have named an unchanged 12, which means that there is a good chance Virat Kohli might field an unchanged playing 11 only for the second time in 42 tests. While Jason Holder and Kemar Roach may make a comeback in the West Indies side. An Indian badminton player, Lakshya Sen, entered the men's singles badminton final at the Youth Olympic Games. Lakshya beat his Japanese rival, Kodai Naruoka, 14-21, 21-15, 24-22 in the semi-final clash to book his place in the next round. And with his entry into the final, India is assured of a medal. Lakshya will next face fifth seed Shifeng Li of China in the summit clash. And India's medal tally has increased to 50 with the 1 gold, 4 silver and 8 bronze in the Asian Para Games at Jakarta. Sharad Kumar smashed 2 records to snare a second successive gold. Sharad bettered the Asian as well as the Games record with a jump of 1.9 meters to claim the top honors in the men's high jump. And earlier, javelin thrower Sundar Singh Gurjar won a silver medal in the men's F46 category. And in the same event, Rinku recorded a personal best of 60.92 meters for the bronze medal. And in men's 400 meters race, Avneel Kumar clocked 52 seconds to fetch a bronze medal. India also bagged medals in other track and field events as well, with Anandan claiming the men's 400 meters silver in the T44 classification, while Vinay Kumar settled for a bronze medal. And that's a wrap on this edition of Breakfast News. But news and updates continue on your channel. Thanks for watching.